Good afternoon, students. Let me quickly revise in 2 minutes whatever we have done so far in these 7 lectures. So let's revise quickly. So far, we have seen the various kinds of ciphers, substitution ciphers and transposition ciphers. In substitution, we had started with monoalphabetic in the form of Caesar cipher. Then we moved towards polyalphabetic ciphers, starting off with Playfair, then Hill cipher, then Wegener cipher, and finally Wernham cipher. After completing all the substitution ciphers, we started our journey of transposition ciphers. We saw that there are two types of basic classification in transposition ciphers, which are keyless transposition and keyed transposition. We saw that Railfenz cipher is one of the keyless transposition cipher, where we don't have the keys. We simply split the plain text into two rows and we start writing them diagonally. And for encryption part, we simply read them row by row. The exact reverse is what we do in the decryption. We divide the plain text. We first of all count the number of we divide the number of characters in the ciphertext. We divide them equally. If they are equal in length, it is very easy to divide them in half. If they are in odd length, we have one character in the first row and one less character in the second row. So this is what we do in the case of a Railfenz cipher. Then we saw what exactly is a simple columnar transposition cipher, how we make the matrices and how we calculate the ciphertext. We also saw there is one more variation to it, that is the simple columnar transposition with double encryption, or we can say double transposition. I had given one question yesterday. Many of you have written the wrong answers because in the question there were two keys given. So it is very obvious that you have to apply the double transposition. Many of you have applied single transposition with the two keys. So entirely the question is wrong. Okay, so many of you have got it wrong. The intention was to check whether you have got the concept or not. Whenever two keys are given in double transposition cipher, or if they don't even mention which transposition cipher you have to use, if two keys are given, it is a clear-cut question of double transposition. That's it. So first of all, you encrypt the plain text using the first key. Whatever result you get, that is a cipher text, you again apply the transposition cipher with the new key. That is the concept. We have already seen it, but many of you have written wrong answers for it. Fine, I have already shared the answers also in Google Classroom. So that's it. We have done this much so far in the seventh lecture. So in today's lecture, what we are going to do is we are going to learn about some basic mathematical fundamentals that are very much required in order to move ahead with the other cryptographic algorithms. Because the encryption techniques we have seen so far are very basic, they are very naive. So we can't have these algorithms in real practice. So we would like to learn about some more application oriented ciphers, some more industry oriented ciphers. But to learn about them, we should know the basic fundamentals of maths. As I've already discussed in the introductory lectures, that your maths have to be really strong for learning cryptography. We have already seen inverse matrix multiplications we have already seen how to calculate the inverse of matrices, how to calculate the inverse of determinants. We have already seen how to calculate the adjoint, adjunct, etc., etc. Right? So we are going to see all those in detail in the coming few chapters, or we can say coming few modules. Today we are going to stick to the topic, which is what we call as modular arithmetic and number theory. And inside that topic, we are first of all going to start off with a very basic concept that we know as GCD, or greatest common divisor. Fine. So shall we start? We have already used the 4 minutes to just introduce you to what we have done so far and what are we going to do in this lecture. So kindly let me know if I'm audible, if the screen is visible properly, then I can start with today's lecture. Okay. So just have a look at this agenda for today. We're going to learn about some modular arithmetic, as I had already explained in the introductory sessions, that I'm going to show you some tips and tricks how we can quickly find out the mod of large numbers. So all that we are going to learn today. Fine. So let's start with our very first topic, that is what we call as GCD, or greatest common divisor. One thing to note, all those who have not yet joined, I am going to close the Meet link in 2 minutes. So kindly ask them to join. I can see only 50 students. So kindly ask your classmates to join soon. I will simply disable the Meet link in the next 2 minutes. Fine, so let's start with today's lecture. The very first topic for the day is GCD, that is Greatest Common Divisor. So any idea what GCD is? Come on, give me your answers. Use the chat box or you can turn your mic on, give me the answers. What exactly is a GCD? Yes. Come on, give me your answers. A very basic question. What exactly? Yeah, full form I know, greatest common divisor. What exactly is it? How is it different from LCM? What is the largest common number which can be used to divide two or more numbers, correct? So if I want to know the GCD of two numbers or two integers, the largest factor, or we can say the largest common number which can divide both the numbers, is nothing but the GCD. Yes or no? So if I have two numbers and I want to find out the GCD of those two numbers, I need to find the largest number which can divide both the numbers. Am I clear? Kindly let me know your answers. Fine. Then how is it different from LCM? This is going to be a very interactive kind of a session. I'm going to keep on asking questions. Today we are only going to focus on mathematics. That's it. How is LCM different from GCD? Are they both same? Are they different? Any idea? Come on, quickly give me answers. What is LCM then? Yeah, they are different. Then how are they different? Okay, fine. We can say LCM is the least common multiple, whereas GCD is greatest common divisor. Both of them have a minute difference. LCM is talking about the multiples, whereas GCD is talking about the divisor. Am I correct? Okay, so LCM is all about finding out the smallest common multiple in both the numbers, where GCD is all about finding the greatest common divisor in both the numbers. Fine. This should be very clear. Now let me quickly see some numbers. Obviously these are very simple numbers to start with. Find out the GCD of 3, 5. It's very simple. I will show the answers also. You don't need to practice this again and again because these are very simple questions. GCD of 3, 5 is equal to 1. Why? Because 3 and 5 are relatively prime to each other. When I say relatively prime to each other, there should not be any factors of those numbers except 1. So only 1 can divide 3 and 1 can divide 5. There are no common factors between them. Am I clear? Yes or no? Very basic concept. We have already seen this. Since our school days, we have been doing such problems, right? So this is the very first introductory problem. Next up, let's see GCD of 12, 60. The simplest way of finding it is like this. Try to write the factors of those numbers. For example, GCD of 12 could be 2 into 2 into 3. That is 2 into 2, 4. 4 into 3, 12. Similarly, the factors of 60 could be 2 into 2 into 3 into 5. So it is nothing but 12 into 5. So what is the common factor over here? The highlighted factors over here is 2 into 2 into 3. That is 12. Am I clear? So I can say that GCD of 12 and 60 is nothing but 12. Clear? Fine. Similarly, GCD of 40, 20. Just have a look. Simply find out the factors of both the numbers. 40 can be written as 2 into 2 into 2 into 5. 8 into 5. Similarly, factors of 20 would be 2 into 2 into 5. So what are the common factors over here? 4 into 5. So it simply means 20. Am I clear? Fine. So it won't be always the same case that whichever number is smaller, that could be the GCD. It is not always the same. We'll see how to find out the GCD of other numbers. For example, over here, GCD of 15 and 12. As you can see, the factors of 15 are 3 into 5. And the factors of 12 are 3 into 4. So in this case, the GCD will be very much simple to find out. It is nothing but 3. Fine. So whichever number divides both the number, whichever is common in both the divisors, the highest value of that number is called as the GCD. Fine with it? Clear? So these were some basics of GCD.
Now we are going to see how to differentiate this with modular arithmetic approach. What exactly is modular arithmetic? So first of all, I will show you exactly what do we mean by modular arithmetic, and then I will straight away jump with the various topics. This question can come for 5 marks. Explain modular arithmetic and what are its various principles. Okay, so just have a look at this definition. Modular arithmetic is a simple concept of using the remainders, which are basically left after an integer division. So if I'm dividing a huge number with a smaller number, we keep on making reuse of the remainder. Whatever remainder we are getting at each step, we are going to make use of that remainder again and again until we get the final remainder as zero. So if we want to divide a larger number with a comparatively smaller number using our long division method, it becomes really huge to solve it. So what we do is we keep on breaking the numbers into smaller parts. We keep on breaking the larger number into smaller modules and then keep on dividing those smaller numbers subsequently. And at the end, whenever we get the remainder as zero, that particular value would be the mod of that operation. So for example, if I want 77 mod 4 or mod 5, for example, just giving you an example. So we keep on taking the mod of 77 by 4, we keep on dividing 77 by 4 until we get the remainder as 0. Whenever we get the remainder as 0, the quotient will be your final mod. I will show you how to do this, don't worry. But for the time being, just read this statement. Modular arithmetic is a simple concept of using the remainder, which is left after an integer operation. So now let us focus upon the various principles of this. These are a few principles. I guess two or three principles are there. A, B, and C, I've written them. So let A, B belong to Z and let N belong to N, where Z is nothing but set of integers and N is nothing but set of natural numbers. So you already have solved some theorems. Sorry. You have solved theorems in the past in mathematics. So it is similar to that only. You are given a statement and you need to prove that statement using an example. Okay. So in this case, there is a statement given, A, B belong to Z and N belong to capital N, belong to a subset of whatever. Then A is congruent to B mod N. Am I clear? You can say that if A and B are if A and B are integers and if small n is a natural number, then we can say that A is congruent to B mod N. Now you know what is congruency, right? So we can say that A is congruent to B mod N. Or in simple terms, what I can say, if I take A mod N, that should be equal to B. Yes or no? Kindly let me know. This is the beauty of this congruency symbol over there. A is congruent to B mod N. So what I can do is I can also say that if I take mod of this A by N, that is if A mod N, that will be equal to B. Yes or no? We have already seen this while calculating the inverse of the determinant, if you remember, in Hill cipher. Yes or no? Yes. The same thing is basically derived from these principles only. Yes. Is it clear? Fine. So let me show you how. So this is the definition part of this theorem. And now, this can be proved only if A minus B upon N. That is, whatever be the number A, whatever be the number B, if I subtract B from A and divide it by N, then it will give me the answer. Let me show you how. Over here, this is a number 23 congruent to 1 mod 11. So according to our logic, we can say that A is 23. So that this is A. This is B. Now you only tell me what is what. According to the formula, what we can do is the congruence calculus is often called as modular arithmetic. It considers that 23 and 11 mod 12 is equivalent. Now can you tell me what exactly is happening over here? This statement, 23 and 11 mod 12 is equivalent. How come? You only tell me. If I consider this formula over here, 12 is your n, where a is 23, b is 11, and n is equal to 12. Now you tell me what is happening exactly. Remainder is same, correct. Now what I can say is, if 23 mod 11 I take, then what is the remainder? 23 mod 11. It is 1, right? So it is satisfying my condition. 23 mod 11 is giving me 1. So first of all, I will check whether the condition is satisfied or not. So the condition is satisfied. Then what I can do is, I can refer this particular formula over here. A minus B upon N. What is A? It is 23. So it becomes 23 minus 11 upon N. What it is going to give me? It is again going to give me the same answer, yes or no. It is again 12 by 12 is equal to 1. Am I clear? Is it clear now? In both the cases, we will get obviously the remainder as 1. Fine. So that is what is mentioned over here. We can say that 23 and 11 mod 12 is equivalent. Why? Because 23 mod 12 is what? What is 23 mod 12? It is going to be 11. Similarly, what is 11 mod 12? It is going to be 11. Yes or no? So we can prove both the ways, LHS, RHS, or if we stick to the expression shown over here, that is A minus B upon N, that should be equal to 1. Both the ways it is correct. Yes or no? Kindly let me know. Fine. So this is the basic principle of the modular arithmetic. Then that whatever number is given to you, you first of all take the mod on the left hand side and check whether dividing the number A by the mod, we get a remainder as 1 or not. It should give a remainder as 1. If it is giving remainder as 1, then we can say that it is following the modular arithmetic principles. This is the very first principle. Am I clear? Shall we move ahead? Kindly let me know. This comes for a theory question, theory point of view. So only 5 to 10 marks question. If it comes for 10 marks, you have to give examples like this one. Again, I'm reading this one, reading this statement for you. The congruence calculus is often called a modular arithmetic. It considers that 23 and 11 mod 12 is both equivalent. 23 mod 12 is 11. 11 mod 12 is again 11, as both the operations give the same remainder, 11. Fine. Shall I move ahead? Kindly let me know in the chat box. Okay, fine. So the next principle or the next statement of this modular arithmetic is, if A and B are basically integers, as you can see, set of integers, if A and B are set of integers, then there exists a Q. Q is nothing but a quotient, and R. R is nothing but a remainder. Fine. So if A and B are some integers, there exists some quotient and some remainder such that B is equal to AQ plus R. So what I can say is, if B is 12, I can say that it is 5 into 2 plus 2. I'm correct, right? So it is nothing but I can say that there exists a quotient. Over here, the quotient is 2. Such that B is equal to AQ plus R, where remainder is again 2. So this is R, this is Q, this is B, and this is A. Am I clear? Fine. So we can break up any two numbers. We can divide any two numbers and show it like this. Correct. Fine. Dividend is equal to divisor into quotient plus remainder. Fine. So over here, B can be broken down or can be divided by A plus into quotient times plus remainder. Fine. This is basic maths. Am I clear? So let's move ahead with the third and the last definition. Modular arithmetic exhibits the following properties, and these are the properties. Just have a look. These are the three properties. We have already seen this in bits and pieces. A mod n plus b mod n, and if I take the whole mod n, that is nothing but a plus b mod n. So for example, if I take mod of, for example, 5 mod 3, it is going to give me answer as 2. If I again take the same values mod by 3, it is again going to give me answer as 2. So can I not say that this and this both are same? Yes or no? Yes or no? If I take mod once or twice or n number of times, it's going to remain the same. Yes or no? Am I clear? Fine, if the mod, the number whose mod I'm taking and the number by which I'm dividing both are same, then it's going to remain the same. For example, 5 mod 3 gives me answer as 2. So I have to take the mod of 2 by 3 and I will again get the answer as 2. Yes or no? Am I clear? Kindly let me know. If I write mod once or if I write mod n number of times, it is not going to make any difference to the solution. That is what is happening over here. We are basically opening up the mod. In maths, as we say, open the brackets, similar to that. It is a mod n plus b mod n. That is what we are doing on the left hand side. Whole divided by mod n. Fine. Similarly, the second formula. Instead of plus, there is a minus. So a mod n minus b mod n whole mod n will give me the same result as a minus b mod n. Fine. And finally, the operation is multiplication. So it is a mod n into b mod n whole mod n is nothing but a into b mod n. Is it clear now? Fine. Very simple thing. This will come for minimum 5 marks, and if it comes for 10 marks, you need to give examples as well. So the question over here is, what exactly is modular arithmetic? Fine. So we have done the first section of today's lecture, that is GCD and modular arithmetic principles or basics. The next topic for the day is Euclidean distance, that is all Euclidean algorithm, also called as Euclid's algorithm. So this is the theory part. I will straight away start with the example first and then try to come back to the theory to make the things easy for you to understand. Okay. So as explained, I'm going to show with the help of a example. Now we need to calculate the GCD of 54 and 888. Now how to do it? Obviously, if you use calculator, it will be simple, but still try to do it manually. Over here, what we are doing is the GCD of 54 and 888. So basically, 888 is the dividend, 54 is the divisor. Whatever remainder we are going to get, just have a look how I did this division. I first considered this 88, okay? What I did is 54, that is 54 ones are 54, and this is the difference. 34 is the difference. I simply write the 8, so it becomes 348. Now, 54 6s are 324. It is not completely divisible, so the remainder is 24 over here. If you remember the very first principle of modular arithmetic, I just now had dictated that modular arithmetic is a simple concept of using the remainder which is left after an integer division. So in this case, the remainder which is left after that operation is 24. So what we are going to do is we are going to check if the remainder is less than the divisor. Obviously, the remainder is less, 24 and 54. We continue the process with the remainder as the new divisor and the old divisor as the dividend. Am I clear? Till this part. We are simply dividing 888 by 54. Okay. Don't use your normal long division method. We are starting from the MSB bit, not from the LSB bit. Am I clear? This is the difference. Or else you may end up doing mistakes. In this case, all the three numbers are same. So mistakes, so chance of doing mistakes are less. But in few examples we are going to see later on, it is not going to be the same answer. Fine. So start with the leftmost bit in this case. So it becomes 54 just beneath the leftmost 88. Fine. Whatever difference you get, obviously 54 can't divide 34. So I have written 8 also. So it becomes 348 and 54 6s are 324. So the remainder we got is 24. Now, according to this rule, if the remainder is less than the divisor, we continue the process with the remainder, whatever remainder we got, as the new divisor. Am I clear? So we are now going to divide 54 by 24. Fine. This is what we are going to get. If we divide 54 by 24, it is directly getting divided. 24 twos are 48. we get the remainder as 6. Again, this 6 is less than 24. Repeat the same process again. So 6 will now divide 24. Now we know that 6 4s are 24. We got a 0 over here. So as explained earlier, whenever we get the 0 as remainder, we check what exactly is the divisor at that point of time. So at some point of time, if we keep on continuing the division, we will eventually get 0 as the remainder. The divisor for that operation will be the required GCD. Yes or no? So now I can say that the GCD of 54 and 88 is 6. Am I clear? Kindly let me know. It is very easy if you do this manually. Even I guess calculator will take some time for calculating the GCD. Yes, so you can easily solve this manually without any extra efforts. Just keep on continuing the traditional division method until you get the remainder as 0. Whenever you get the remainder as 0, the corresponding divisor will be your GCD. Fine? Okay. Still, if any one of you has not got how to do this, kindly let me know in the chat box. I could simply repeat it if you want. Fine? Okay, so I guess everyone is now getting the basic knowledge about this. I guess the concept is clear. Fine. So what exactly I have done over here is, if you see this step number 2 or the principle number 2, B is equal to AQ plus R. So I have written the same number in this format, just for a simulation sort of thing, just for explaining the concepts. So I can write 888 as, again, refer to the division that you have just now performed. It will be 54 times 16 plus 24. Keep on continuing that. 54 will now be 24 times 2 plus 6. And 24 is nothing but 6 times 4 plus 0. So this also obeys the principle, that is B is equal to AQ plus R. So this entire thing you have to write if the question comes for calculate the GCD of the following number. Am I clear? So if the question is asked, calculate the GCD of 54 and 888 for 5 marks or 10 marks, you can't simply use your calculator and directly write the answer. You need to write all these steps, and whatever theory of modular arithmetic is concerned with that question, you have to write that also. So you have to write this particular step number 2, because this is what is being used over here, right? And this basic definition of modular arithmetic, that is, what exactly is modular arithmetic? Write one of these definitions that you are going to use over here in this problem, in the solution, and then start solving the question. So whichever question is asked, even if it's a problem, you need to add the theory behind that problem also, a background theory. Am I clear? Simply starting off with the problems will not give you full marks. I've seen it with the TCS papers also. So you can't simply write the answers straight away. You can't simply start with writing the problems. You need to give the theory part also. Fine? Am I clear? Is it clear? Can I move ahead with the theory behind Euclidean algorithm? Okay, we have used 30 minutes. We still have 30 minutes and we have a lot of topics to be covered. Wait a minute. Before going there, I would like to show one more topic, how to solve large mod operations. I was waiting for this topic because you are going to need this. Obviously, whenever you will start your chapter number 2 and chapter number 3, which is all about public key cryptography, and whatever you are going to learn over here, learn it thoroughly, keep on practicing problems, because you are going to need it again and again in those chapters, chapter 2 and 3. Okay, so just have a look. I have taken a smaller number. You can take multiple number, a huge number also. So basically, it is 5 raised to 15 mod 23. I guess raised to power 15 can be solved in CalCI. But at some point of time, you may run out of space in your calculators also. For example, you can take a number like this. 7 raised to 79 mod 33. You can't solve this number using your calculator. So you need some sort of a manual way using which you can solve your problems. Right? So over here, just have a look. What exactly I have done. Can you tell me the answer of this 5 raised to 15 mod 23 before I start the calculation? Can any one of you let me know the answer before I actually start the problem? Then we can move on with the second problem that I have written on the left hand side. 7 raised to 79 mod 33 based on the techniques we are going to learn now. It's very simple. You simply need to break up all the parts into multiple modules, that is what we call as modular arithmetic. Yes or no? So kindly try and let me know the answer for this quickly in 1 minute or 2 minute maximum. Then I will show you the steps. 5 raised to 15 mod 23. Let me know what answer you're getting. Obviously, the answer is going to be a unique one. No, Jyoti, not that unique. It can't be zero. 5 raised to 15 mod 23. Let me know the answers. Correct, Dhruv. Dhruv has got the answer. Dhruv, Sheth, Puneet, correct. The answer is 19. Now, let me show you how. You must have used your calculators or have you done manually? Dhruv, Puneet, Jay, kindly let me know, have you done it manually or taken help of any calculator? Calculator, okay, fine. So let me show you how to do this without any calculator. Some basic operations, basic maths to anai chahiye sabko, right? So it is 5 raised to 15, a mod 23. What you need to do is, first of all, start with 5 mod 23. It is nothing but 5, fine? Now what you can do is, you have to keep on increasing the powers or doubling up the powers. Now I will go with 5 square mod 23. 5 square mod 23 is nothing but whatever result you got in the previous step, you have to square it up. So for example, 5 square mod 23 will be square of this 5. That is, square of 5 is 25 mod 23. You will get the answer as 2. Now I will again double up the power. It will be 5 raised to 4 mod 23. 5 raised to 4 mod 23 is nothing but again square the answer of the previous step. So square of 2 is nothing but 4. So it will be 4 mod 23. And as you know, 4 mod 23 is 4. Finally, 5 raised to 8 mod 23 is nothing but again square the powers. Squaring means squaring the result of the previous step. So it is 16 mod 23. I have directly written the answer as 16. So shall I need to move ahead? Or can we stop over here? Shall I continue calculating the powers? Or I can stop over here? Yes, I can stop. Because if I move further one more step, it will be 5 raised to 16. And I don't want that. What I want to say is, I can get 5 raised to 15 using this. 5 raised to 15 is nothing but 5 raised to 8 plus 4 plus 2 plus 1. Yes or no? It is basically, the base is common, that is base is 5. So I can simply multiply them. And if I multiply them, I am simply adding up the powers. Yes or no? Basic indices. Right? So it is nothing but 5 raised to 8 multiplied by 5 raised to 4 multiplied by 5 raised to 2 multiplied by 5 raised to 1. The base is common. So I can simply add up the powers. Yes or no? Come on, quickly give me answers. Yes. Fine. So what we need to do is, instead of taking powers, now what happens is the calculator fails at some point of time. Over here, your calculator will not give you correct answer. Because at some point of time, it will run out of memory. Because you are continuously taking powers of 7. 7 square, 7, 4, 7 raised to 8, 16 and so on. So it will eventually run out of memory. So what we are doing is, we are converting the squaring operations into multiplication operations. Now, multiplications will not take that much space as compared to squaring. So what we are doing is, we are improving the efficiency in terms of space. Am I clear? Is it clear now? Because what happens is, squaring will take a lot of memory as compared to multiplying. It's simple efficiency rules. You have already seen space efficiency, time efficiency, complexity, etc. So I'm talking in terms of that only. Squaring operations obviously will take more number of space as compared to multiplication operations. Am I clear or not? One quickly, let me know. Yes. Okay, fine. So that is what we are going to do over here. We are basically going to multiply all these numbers, 5 raised to 8. That is the result of these values. 16 into 4 into 2 into whatever I got over here, that is 5 mod 23. That is shown over here. So answer would be 16 into 4 into 2 into 5 mod 23. That you can do without calculator also. So it becomes 64 into 10 mod 25, 640 mod 23. And if needed, you can take the help of a calculator at this point of time. Otherwise, everything else can be done manually. If your maths is strong, you can even get the answer for this also. Fine. Yes or no? So the answer would be 19. Correct. So now try to solve the question I have given over here. That is 7 raised to 79 mod 23 and give me the answers. Come on, quick. This is just for practice to let me know whether you got the concept or not. So kindly solve this problem quickly. 7 raised to 79 mod 33. So let me tell you, it will be like 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32 and 64. So we need to calculate the power till 64. Am I clear? Because once I go beyond that, it will go beyond the power of 79. So I will stop at 7 raised to 64 value. So I need to calculate 7. 7 square, 7 raised to 4, 7 raised to 8, 7 raised to 16, 7 raised to 32 and 7 raised to 64. And at that point of time, I will get the answer. Fine. Harsh, let me check. I have not solved this problem. Let the others also give the answers. I've just given randomly. Let's check what the answer could be. Okay, just take 2 minutes and try to solve the answer. At least start solving it. Okay, coincidentally, the answer is same. It is 19 only, as Harsh has mentioned. But at least try. Check the intermediate steps. It is like this. 7 raised to 1 mod 33 will be 7. 7 square mod 33 will be nothing but square of this. That is 49 mod 33. What is the answer of that? I'm not wrong. Yes or no? 16. Correct. Next will be 7 raised to 4 mod 33. That is 16 square. What is 16 square? Come on, give me answers. Quick maths. Yes. 256. Correct. So what will be 256 mod 33? Simple calculation. Tell me the answer for this. I'm not solving it. I'm trusting you. So what will be 256 mod 33? 25. Okay, I'm getting some answers. It will be 25. Next, 7 raised to 8 mod 33 will be 25 square. That is 625, I guess. What is it? Answer 31. Okay, so 625 mod 33 will give you answer as 31. Next is 7 raised to 16. I'm not writing the intermediate steps. Tell me the answers. 31 mod 33 will be 31 only. I guess it will start repeating now. Okay, sorry, 31 square. I forgot. Yeah. It will be 31 square mod 33. Answer is 4. Okay, fine. Answer is 4. Then it will be 7 raised to 32. 4 ka hota 16. 16 mod 33, 16, I guess. Now it will start repeating. Yes or no? It will. If once I get repeating characters, the next mod is always going to be same. So it's not that tough. Once you start getting repeated characters, you will again get the same answers. Samjha abhi sabko, is it clear? Fine. So these are the values you are going to make use of. So it is basically 25 into 16. Now let's try to add up the powers. We need the answer in terms of 7 raised to 79, right? If I'm not wrong. 7 raised to 79. So how will you get 79? We'll add up 7 raised to 64 dot 7 raised to 8, I guess, or 16. If I add 16, it will become 80. So I need to add 7 raised to 8. So it becomes simple maths, 72. Now I can add 4, it becomes 76. I can add 2, it becomes 78. And I can add 1, it becomes 79. So I need to multiply all these values and take mod by 33, and you will get the answer as 19. Am I clear now? Intentionally, I took a lot of time in this. I guess the answer is 19 if I'm not wrong. Some of you are getting answers as 8. Kindly check. Okay, sorry, that was the exponent power. Fine. So it is 7 raised to 64, dot 7 raised to 8, dot 7 raised to 4, dot 7 raised to 2, dot 7 raised to 1. So the only concept you need to keep in mind is the powers need to add up to 79. So don't make a mistake of adding all the powers. Obviously, you're going to get a wrong answer for that. Correct? You need to go till 64th power in this case, because if I go further, that will be 7 raised to 128. That is not needed at all. So I will stop over there. 7 raised to 64 is fine. Then try to add the powers from here and you will end up getting the answer as 19. Fine. Any confusions with this? So using this, you can solve modulus of large operations. You can cross-check using various online websites available. Okay. But in the exam, you can't use the websites, right? So, and we hope that this time the exam will be offline only. So you won't have any access to them. Right. So just have a look. You can check this website. Just quickly cross-check your answers. Right. So I cross-check my answer. It comes out to be 19 only. Fine. Okay. So can we move ahead? We still have some time left. I can move ahead with the next topic. Kindly let me know. Okay, fine. So we have done these two topics and this complementary topic also, how to solve large mod operations. It is not part of the syllabus, but still you should know this. This will save a lot of your time. Okay. Now let's start with the Euclidean algorithms theory that we have seen just now. Okay, the Euclidean algorithm, that is this one, calculating GCD of numbers. Okay, so let's study the theory of this. It is a basic technique or a method for calculation of GCD of two positive numbers. Now we have just now seen how to calculate the GCD of numbers. That is, I'm not going to dictate each and every term. I will obviously share the PDF. So that's why I had taken the example first to make the things clear. So this is what we did. A is equal to Q1B plus R1. And whatever result we get, we check whether that remainder is lesser than the divisor or not. If it is less than that, then we keep on continuing the process until we get the remainder as zero. When we get the remainder as zero, we simply write that D is nothing but GCD of R1, R2. So in summary, in totality, I can say that the division process continues till the remainder is zero. Is it clear? I'm not focusing on the theory again and again because I have explained this entire concept much in detail using this explanation, using this example. Fine. Kindly let me know if it is clear. Just have a look at this definition once again. Dhruv, no audio, you are saying? Kindly check. What about others in B division? Kindly let me know if I'm audible or not. Audible, right? Okay. Dhruv, kindly check your network connection. If needed, kindly rejoin once again. Okay, fine. So this is the basic theory of Euclidean algorithm. So in the exam, if the question is asked, explain what is Euclidean algorithm or Euclid's algorithm, both are same thing. So you need to write the theory first, this particular theory. It's exactly the same theory that I have shown using that example. So don't worry, R1 ka se aaya, R2 ka se aaya. R1 is nothing but the first remainder. R2 is nothing but the second remainder. If R1 is less than B, that is nothing but the divisor, we again apply the same formula. That is what we have seen just now, right? We continue the process and at the end, we stop when the remainder is zero. Fine. So in terms of computer engineers, we are computer engineers, right? So we need to form the algorithm. So this could be termed as the algorithm for this particular formula. This is Euclid x comma y. This can be called as the pseudo code for that. We initialize two variables x and y. What we do is, if y is zero, that is in the very first instant, if the remainder is zero, then what we do, it is completely divisible, then we can't have any GCD for that. So what we do is x is nothing but whatever GCD we get at that point of time, that will be your final GCD. That is, we have to stop at that point, right? Whenever we get the remainder as zero, we stop over there. So that is what is being shown over here. The process continues till we the process continues till the remainder is zero. So we first of all check whether the remainder is zero or not. If it is zero, then we stop then and there. Otherwise, we move further and calculate the remainder from the previous step. So over here, r is nothing but the remainder. Remainder is x mod y. For example, if x is 7, y is 3, it will be 7 mod 3, and the answer will be 1, and so on. So now the remainder will be 1, and then we will check if it is 0. If it is 0, we'll stop over there. If it is not 0, we will assign the new value of x to be y and the new value of y to be r. And we continue the entire process again and again until step number 2 is verified. That is, until the remainder is 0. Am I clear? I will take one example. Don't worry. How to solve it, I will take an example and show you. For the time being, this is your algorithm that you should follow. And you may have some programs in your experimental sessions also. Create an algorithm or design an algorithm for Euclid's distance. Then you can use this pseudo code or use this snippet. Fine with it. Can I move ahead with the problems based on this? I have a lot of problems for practice. So don't worry, we'll get the hang of it. Fine. So let's start with the very first problem. I have solved it, but the next problems are going to be unsolved. So we have to calculate the GCD of 40, 20. We know the answer is 20. So that's why I have taken this problem, just to show you how it is to be solved. Now, if we follow our algorithm, we know that y is not 0. The second term is not 0. This is nothing but x, this is y, right? So we check what is x, what is y. What is x? X is 40 and y is 20. Because otherwise, if I say that 40, 0, what will be the GCD of this? The GCD will be 40 only, yes or no? So the second value cannot be 0, right? Yes or no? Because if I compare any two values, if I want to take the GCD of 40, 0, it is not possible. It will be 40 only. Yes or no? Yes, come on, give me answers. Yes, fine. So we always check whether the second value is 0 or not. If the second value is 0, we simply straight away take the GCD of both the numbers and assign it to x. But in this case, it is not so. So we will continue with step number 3. Now, how it is to be solved? This is the formula that you need to keep in mind. Okay, check this step. GCD of x, y, we are simply going to change their positions. We'll take the first parameter as y, and second parameter would be x mod y. Take this into consideration. This is important. We are going to invert the positions. Now GCD will be y, x mod y. So it is nothing but GCD of 20, 40 mod 20. This is your algorithm. If you see over here, if you see the fourth step, this is nothing but that only, and the fifth step. So what we are doing is, new x would be y, and new y would be the remainder. Am I clear? That is what we have done over here. So the new x is nothing but y, and the new y is nothing but the remainder. Is it clear? Is it fine? Yes? No doubts? Okay. So the next step would be to find out the GCD of 20, 40 mod 0. Now 40 mod 20. Now we know that 40 is completely divisible by 20. So the remainder will be 0 in this case. So it simply translates to GCD of 20, 0. Now we know that if we take the GCD of any number with 0, it is going to be the same number only. So we can say that now, according to our algorithm, step number 2, if we go to step number 2, it is, if y is 0, return x is equal to GCD of x, y. Now I know that GCD of 20, 0 is 20. So that will be my answer. That is, GCD is this. Is it clear now? If I don't get this answer as 0, if I don't get y as 0, we keep on continuing the above step again and again in a loop until we get the final answer. Fine? Okay. So can I move ahead?
Kindly let me know.
Okay. Okay, fine. I find today's attendance is very short. I don't know what is the reason. Let's see. Okay, next question. Now I want you to solve this. GCD of 36, 10. You only tell me what should come in these blank spaces. GCD of 36, 10. Obviously, the first condition is satisfied. Y is not 0. So what should be written over here? Come on, tell me the answers. Okay, correct. We have to interchange the positions. So it becomes 10. It becomes 36 mod 10. So now the first value is going to be 10. And over here we know 36 mod 10 is 6. Yes? Fine? Okay. So now we need to continue because the second value is not 0. So we need to continue with 10, 6. And now invert the positions. It becomes 6 over here. It becomes 10 over here. Mod 6. Yes or no? So the answer would be 6, 4. Now move ahead further. It will be 6, 4. We interchange the positions. It becomes 4 over here. 6 mod 4. And finally, the answer would be 6 mod 4 is 2. So we check for 4, 2. We'll get 2 over here. It will be 4 over here. It will be 2 over here. So it is 2, 0. So what will be the answer? You only tell me. Come on. Answer is 2. You can cross-check your answers. You can verify your answers. But this is one of the most easiest way of calculating GCDs. The same thing which I had shown you using the long division method. It's the same thing only. It is applied in algorithm. Fine? Am I clear? You can say that GCD of 36 and 10 is 2. Fine? Now try to solve this question 48, 30 and give me the answers. These are your homework questions. Or you can even try. We have still got time. GCD of 48, 30. Tell me the answers. And GCD of 105, 80. Give me the answers. Fine. Just try it. We have still got 7 minutes. In the meantime, I will drop the attendance link. So that's it for this lecture. Try the questions and give me the answer over here only in the chat box. Thanks a lot. So I guess now you're in a position to solve these questions. Right. So it becomes 80 and 25. So it becomes 80, 25 ka GCD. So it's nothing but 25. 80 mod 25. Now we know 25, 3s are 75 with a remainder 5. So it becomes 25, 5. And last up, 25, 5 is nothing but 5 and 25 mod 5. So it becomes 5, 0. So the answer for this is 5. Fine. So any more issues, any more doubts with this, you can let me know. Otherwise, we can stop this lecture over here.